Good evening, folks, and welcome you all at another episode from Amrita Vishwavidyapeetha, the Big Talk. As usual, we have with us Brahmachari Maheshwara Chaitanya Ji, who is the chairman for admissions into all the four campuses of Amrita School of Engineering. He also holds the responsibility of as the Deputy Controller of Exams for Amritapuri campus. And of course, is the Associate Director for the most sought after competition, ICPC, International Collegiate Programming Contest. And as usual, we all begin this session with the blessings of our Chancellor, Mata Amritamayi Deviji, who is a world-renowned spiritual leader, and whatever the university is today is all because of the blessings of Amma showered on us. So as the usual practice goes, it'll be our honor to have Swamiji lighting the lamp of knowledge and seeking the blessing of our Chancellor Amma and showering Thank you, Swamiji, and we have the speaker today, the guest today we have from Dubai, and I'm sure it is around 2:30 there, ma'am. 2:30.
Yeah.
What's the time there?
2:30.
Yeah, and she is. It's a Friday, so it's a holiday for them in Dubai. She is Sindhu Pillai, right? And she has sent us a brief write-up on her. Has been not working for a reputed training and consulting company in Dubai. She continues to be a volunteer with Art of Living, and she has all that she to become a teacher in the future. So yoga and meditation was introduced for Sindhu as early as in her life. I'm sure it may be in the school days, and to be precise, yes, to be precise, during the school days. She was going through the Art of Living and grace of our gurus. Heavenly angels walked into her life, and she is the founding member of Heavenly Angels. It's a support group for families of special need children, in bracket, rather like Dubai calls them, people of determination, bracket close. It's more for the families who need support, for she believes the angels are perfect. They simply need to be accepted and served. I'm sorry. They are blessings like any other child who comes on planet Earth. So Sindhu, in fact, we are glad to have you here for this session, the Big Talk. And before we begin our discussions, it'll be my pleasure to invite Swamiji for his opening remarks and a couple of clarifications that he would go through looking at your profile. And over to you, Swamiji, for your million-dollar question to Sindhu.
I hope I'll be able to answer.
Yeah. Don't, Sindhu, don't feel that nervous. He's going to ask you a very simple question.
Yes,
very simple question.
Namaste, Swamiji.
I think it is the right time we do this program because of the pandemic situation. People undergoing severe anxiety and pressure, and we all know that this is something which we have to contain within, or to accept the reality. Losing of the jobs, pay cuts, and finding it difficult to accommodate ourselves in the four walls. And let us take this as a positive session, or let us take this as a session where we can deliver the best to the audience. So my understanding about spirituality is, you accept whatever comes to you with a positive attitude. I don't believe that there is something which is positive and negative. Whatever comes in, we have to accept. Or at least make sure that it is not affecting our mind and routine. So when you say that, the scientific temper and spiritual understanding, what is it that, or what is the takeaway in this context? What is it that we can learn by applying this concept in this present context?
Let me take off from the same sentence of acceptance. I think acceptance is the key of not only situations, but of people as well. And spirituality comes in there when you are able to accept people and situation as they are. And you learn to live in the present moment. That is what is expected of us, and how many of us are able to do it is where spirituality comes in. What I meant is that there is a science of spirituality, especially it would be like, unless I believe this totally, I believe that unless you're a science student, you know, understanding spirituality might be a little difficult, because spirituality is nothing but science. We talk about vibrations, we talk about energy, we talk about all of this, which is basic of physics, I think. And so a scientific mind would find spirituality definitely attractive. And that's where I also came in, I guess, with a logic mind and a science mind. You know, you slowly move into spirituality and then it opens up a totally new realm. And that is something fantastic. You have to go through it. It's a path. You have to go through it to experience it. That's how I feel.
Swamiji, I don't know. She said because she's got a background of physics, you two have a background of computer application. I don't have a background of any science, and that could be one of the reasons that I am not able to get into spirituality so far, isn't it? So, because I'm not a science graduate, I'm totally an arts graduate. I had done my economics, you know, in Madras University, and still trying to get into spirituality. Now, the secret of getting into spirituality, I have to go and start learning physics. Books apart. Anyway, over to, I'm sure Swamiji is going to a bit of a counter attack on your statement. I know. I was preparing your mind, Sindhu, so that you're ready with yet another answer of the question that Swamiji is going to ask you now. Over to you, Swamiji.
The most crucial part when we talk about spirituality is there is a misconception that the spirituality is for the people who leave the crowd or run away from the crowd or run away from the situations, but that is not the right way of perceiving it. And how do you think that you apply the spirituality or the science of spirituality in the everyday life for a person who is very fast in life? For example, let us say an administrator or a kind of a person who is a CEO or a general manager who is in charge of a lot of people and running an organization. So how do you think that in this fast and modern world, the concept of spirituality, or when you talk about acceptance, it can be applied, especially from terms of administration and management? I think you are muted.
Mute. You are muted, Sindhu. You are muted. Your mic.
No.
Yeah. Now you are audible.
Now it's okay. Okay. All right. Fine. The first question was to practice spirituality from being away from the society. I think doing that actually would be easier, but that's not what we really want. And we cannot really move ourselves away from the society because we are all a social animal. We need the society. I think that's where the whole challenge is, to practice spirituality while you are in the society, fulfilling all your responsibilities. Because when you are moving away, it would more look like, you know, you're moving away from your responsibilities as well. No. What I believe is that be in your present situation and then practice spirituality, which might be a much more difficult challenge, but then much more fulfilling also. Another thing about the fast-paced life, that is so true. Nowadays, what happens is that people have more things to do and less time with them. And that is where the whole equation becomes fast-paced. Not only less time, but less energy as well. The energy is not up to, if you have enough energy, you would be able to fulfill more. But here, it's all again the science of spirituality, energy. Energy comes in here. Now, what you can do is to increase your energy, which you have many sources of energy like food, sleep, etc. But the most powerful, I would say, is the Turiyavastha in meditations. That is the actual source of energy, I feel. So even if you would sit in for 15 to 20 minutes a day, start with even 10 minutes, that meditative state of mind will definitely give you more energy, more enthusiasm, and more positivity in your life. And your daily challenges, I won't say it would be a breeze, but definitely you would sort of face it with a much more balanced mind. And when you have less stress, when it is less stressful, you will be more productive.
So can you just throw some light on the science of meditation? How is it possible that sitting with the closed eyes for maybe for 15-20 minutes, how can I make it possible that I can balance the mind throughout the day?
Interesting. This is a question that most of my friends used to ask me, because I'm used to taking around 15 to 20 minutes in the morning. I go early to my office. One is that I can beat traffic. Two is that I like to sit down for 15, 20 minutes before I start my day and I meditate. What exactly happens is that I always compare mind to your cell phones. You know, in the cell phone, you have something called gallery, and it is full. It's full of pictures, full of videos. And then what happens? Your phone starts hanging up. So what do you do? You go to the gallery, you start deleting, you clear chat, cleaning up and deleting stuff so that your phone works better. It's the same with your mind. Your mind is filled with memories, impressions, good, bad, tiring, all of it. And there is very little space for you to actually process. So what we do during meditation is delete these memories, these impressions, so that you have space. Space is what is energy. When you have enough space, you're able to process better. So even 15 minutes of what you do really clears you up and makes you really ready for the rest of the day.
So if the deleted file comes back to the gallery, what will happen?
You'll have to go and delete it again.
So how many times I have to do, or what is the way by which I can purge it from the cell phone?
Sorry, I didn't get that.
How can I purge it? How can I remove it forever?
See, it's not going to go overnight. You'll have to keep working on it. So every time, let's say that your gallery is completely empty, and then again it's going to fill up. Your gallery is not filling up again with the same pictures, right? It's with a different type of pictures. So you keep deleting them. Sometimes you won't even go and see the picture again because you know it's already something you don't want. Mm. So your memory won't get filled up, but then will be getting filled up with new things. Mm. Again, memory is not a bad thing because you need some memory. Even walking, how do you walk? It's a memory that you put your leg forward, you can walk. So it's not a bad thing, you need it. But only thing is that you need space as well to process thoughts. So ideally, I would say twice a day, do your meditations. If not, at least definitely once.
Okay. So thank you, ma'am. Let me take a short leave. I think Krish will lead from here.
Thank you very much, Swami.
You'll come back, right? You'll come back.
I'm not sure. I'll text you.
Yeah, that's okay. Your positiveness itself makes me so delighted, you know. Before Swamiji leaves, you know, like I want to ask her, I would like to, Sindhu to tell me that God has given me some superpower now. Instead of me sitting for a meditation for 15 minutes or twice a day, 15 plus 15, 30 minutes, Sindhu, I'm 60 plus. The power God has now given me is that God automatically deletes because I keep forgetting things, right? Is that forgetting things automatically is deleting it? Like you people need to delete it voluntarily. For me, involuntary. What? I forget names, I forget dates, I forget so many things. His forgetfulness is the best thing that God has given to all of us, right? Imagine if you don't forget. Correct?
Totally agree. Because I'm on my way to forgetfulness.
Yeah, correct. You're taking my steps in the future, right? Okay, very good. Welcome to that society of forgetfulness. Okay, coming back. Swami, I will certainly give you a small little call at around 4:45-4:50 because, you know, when you come open the talk and when the closure comes, if Swami is not there, you know, somehow I feel, I don't know, I mean, how can I express what I feel, but suddenly I feel totally off the hooks when Swami is not there to close the show. So, around 4:55, I will come back to you, Swami. So, till then, I'll engage Sindhu with some questions. The first question to Sindhu is, Sindhu, we have picked up a particular topic that is education beyond borders. Yep. You know, we are all confused with the meaning of education. You know, most of us think education is having many number of degrees, right? Or you get into doctorate, you do a research and then become a doctor. You call yourself as so-and-so PhD. Then you become educated. But for me, to define education, these degrees don't make you an educated person. Why? Because these degrees make you a literate person. If you have many number of degrees, they'll show the fingers and say, hey, look at Sindhu. She's a literate personality. Look at Krish. He is a literate personality, but not educated. Because the education is complete only when you start following certain, you know, ethics, certain culture, certain type of good behavior. So all this put together with your degree makes you an educated person. Is that what I feel is right or wrong? You can certainly add or delete from whatever I said. Now, is there a border for education? I mean, is there something circled within the word called education? I thought education was open to everybody, right? In fact, India today is the latest NEP 2020 says by 2035, 50% of our children who start off from LKG will complete higher education. So it is a wonderful thing that education is open to all. And why did we actually choose that word education beyond borders? So can you add some little more flavor to
definitely.
This topic which we decided to have it today?
Over to you, Sindhu.
Absolutely. Yeah, please.
You know, before we talk about education, let's have an insight on education providers. I don't mean institutions. Let's talk about teachers. You know, in our society, we have something called Mata, Pita, Guru, Deva. That means you start your early teachers are your mother, father, guru is your teacher, and we go ahead to Devam. That's God himself. Now, what I see in the current scenario is respect for guru. You know, this is something very much missing in today's scenario. I don't find gurus being given the respect that they deserve. This is where the whole equation has come to a sort of, you know, getting diluted, I must say. the profession has got diluted as time goes. You know, actually speaking, it got diluted when we were in school, I guess, you know, but then of course we used to imitate our teachers, but we never dared to do that in front of our parents, because you know, we know what it was like. They would really be furious if you do that to your teachers. But now with this online, especially with COVID and this online teaching that's going on, you really see teachers being mocked at? That is so sad. And who is mocking at these teachers? Along with the children, the parents. Is that where even these parents come from? What's happening to our society? What's happening to the respect that we were supposed to give teachers? You know, and unless they're coming from that space, what would they give to your children? They are providing not just knowledge or some education. That knowledge needs to transform to wisdom for your own child. So for very selfish reasons itself, we should go back to respecting our teachers. You know, funny thing was, I recently saw one of my friends. He came on Zoom and I was asking him, what is it behind you? So I could see his child's video. I mean, child playing behind. So you know what he told me? Ha, Sindhu, that is like, you know, in Zoom, my son has recorded this and he keeps it as his background so that his teacher thinks that he is there and listening. So that's what is happening to online classes now. Literally, you'll feel that the child is there and listening to you. He's not even there. He's gone away. So what is this online? I mean, what online learning is going on there? I have no idea. Also, somewhere down the lane, I feel it's a two-way thing. You know, we actually, teachers started losing the passion of teaching. All this we could contribute to the quality of our education. And what I would say is that teachers have lost passion for teaching. Children are not the same, of they're not coming from the receiving mode. I think there is something fundamentally wrong here. We should bring back the respect that the teachers deserve. And unless we do that, I don't think a lot of education is going to be happening. I still remember the teachers who molded me right from my KG days, from Chakrabani ma'am, and then Tulsi miss, grade one Valsala ma'am, Valsala miss, Poduwal sir. It goes up to in the school, Devaki miss. When it comes to college, it comes to Haridas sir, Devi miss. And then when I came to my art of living, it was Mahesh sir, Sangeeta ji, Saji Nisan Yusuf sir, Vinay ji. I remember all my teachers, and it's a reverence to them. You know, all that they have been giving, that's what I am today. So I think basically we need to go back to respecting our teachers if we want to progress in education.
I fully agree with you, Sindhu, whatever you have mentioned. But then, you know, you spoke about Mata, Pita, Guru, Devam, initial stages. Initially, you are with your mom, then the dad takes care, then you come to the guru, and then of course is the God. I agree with all those. But today they say, on a lighter note, Mata, Pita, Google, Deva. All right. The guru is being replaced by the Google. Whether you agree, disagree, I'm not trying to argue with you on
Google,
this. But
Google definitely cannot replace Guru.
Number two, respect for the teachers. I think respect for the teacher. Yes, I don't know. I mean, in the sense that the type of respect that you used to give to the teachers is totally different from the type of respect that the current children are giving to their teachers. Absolutely no doubt about it. But when you say about respect, we are, in fact, I always say respect is not for the elders. Because as a parent, we all teach our children respect elders. You know, the moment you say, please respect the elders. But in my opinion, respect has nothing to do with caste, creed, religion, age, position, status, how much money you have. Nothing to do. So when I say respect, I would say when I go to orient children on life skills, I say respect all. Respect even non-human. You have a pet at home, respect the pet. So I would say that respect has to be given to receive respect. Sindhu, if I don't respect you as a human being, as a good friend of mine. Do you think you'll respect me? No. So respect is not just I remember the teachers used to respect the students, those types. I mean, in the sense, not that, get up when the student comes, but there is a bonding. Absolutely, there's a bonding between the teacher and the student and the teacher. But this respect is still there, Sindhu, in my understanding that, but the bonding between the teacher, that gap is being, it's enlarging. So give respect, take respect. So even if there are some teachers who are listening to us, teachers, there's no harm. Yesterday I had a class and I was telling the teachers, it doesn't matter if the student has not wished you. Don't get angry with him. You can go and say, good afternoon, my dear child. Good evening, my dear child. Right? Don't expect people to get up. By getting up is not a respect. Getting up, the child will have something inside the mind. What the bloody hell, yeah, this teacher has come now. Huh? I have to get up. Huh? But they get up. So respect is within. So share the respect, give and take take respect. I think that is what is the second point, which I wanted to. Maybe I'm wrong.
You're the speaker. No, you're absolutely right. I am taking the
liberty of, just from my own mind. Don't mistake me, Sindhu, that I invited you and then I'm talking.
I'm enjoying it. I get all to right, hear
thank
you.
So much. Otherwise, now you can take on to the next point. Otherwise, I have a very bad habit of interrupting my speakers and that. I keep talking. Don't get wild and angry on me on that. Okay. Go ahead with your points.
No, that's what I meant about, I think.
Absolutely.
That's it. We could move ahead.
Yeah. Okay. Fine. So if that was the case, let me ask you yet another clarity. What would be the ideal, best mode of education? What would be, now you said, it is not so. You mentioned so many names of teachers, right? I can understand the type of, I can only tell few teachers' name. And if you ask me about my degree teachers, not a single teacher I can remember. Because, only when you go to classes and attend classes, who teaches. So, in your case, you set some 5-6 teachers' name, professors' name in your college, right? And that is wonderful. I just can't remember maybe one teacher, two teachers in my degree times. Though I also have completed my degree. When you say about all this, Sindhu, I would like a clarification. Which do you recommend is the ideal mode of education? What type of an ideal mode of education you would tell all of us that this is the best way to go about in terms of education? Over to you, Sindhu.
Yeah, that's a question for thought, because during this COVID time, there's a lot of insights that's been happening. We are being exposed to new areas, and in our case, like I told you, we have a support group called Heavenly Angels, and we could see the COVID period was not easy for the parents. So just to distract their mind so that they are not caught up in, always having a child there and the anxiety part of it, we started with something called summer camp. The summer camp idea itself came in when we realized online dance classes were doing well with our children. During the summer camp, it was the mothers themselves who became teachers. It's not that we wanted to replace any teacher or something, but then we didn't have anybody else to actually take the classes. So we said, why not the mothers try? And they did a wonderful job, a really good job. And that was online. The whole thing was online. That's when I started thinking, might be online works for my children. But it's not something of not only we're coming to angels, but throughout I feel we have a confused set of parents as well as children, because now online has been introduced. We have something called offline. Now we have got something called homeschooling, NIOS, Zane Education. Australia has a very different type of education. So what is the best practice? If you ask me, I'll say it's a combination. One cannot replace the other. Online classes cannot replace a on-site classroom. Or a certain type of homeschooling might not be able to replace it with a regular schooling. You need social interaction. It has to be a combination is what I feel. See what actually suits your child as a parent, especially as a mother. You sorry, you would be knowing your child much better. You could go ahead with them. Sometimes, you know, homeschooling might be the best solution. So you should be looking in with a clear mind. You shouldn't be having a stressed out mind, an anxious mind, and then looking for solutions. You're not going to find any. You will have to look around with a calm mind and find what suits your child the best. So if you ask me, I'll say it's a combination of various modes of education.
Sindhu, thank you so much. And I also believe now you're in Dubai, I'm in India. And people talk something about this blended teaching learning process, which means that having experienced live classes going on for the last 3 or 4 months now, it is not going to be the old style of teaching learning process where you have 6 days in a week and children go all the 6 days to school and attend classes. I don't think that's going to happen. So what I generally feel is that out of 6 days, maybe 4 days to school and 2 days of still, you know, teaching from the house by the teacher to the students who are at home. I think it's going to be a blended mixture of both, as you rightly said. And no more things are going to be as it was about 4 or 5 months back before the COVID-19 came into existence. So I'm willing to accept whatever you said, that there could be, you know, live classes cannot compensate, you know, the real classroom experiences. As you said, the children want to experience the school, you know, the atmosphere of a school. I mean, even today, you go back to your school where you were studying, you know, you see those people. I see the alumni meets where those huge grown-up guys of 50s and 60s going to the classroom, sitting on the same bench and say, hey, this is the bench I used to, let's sit here for 5. You know, even today at the age of 60, if somebody gets the pleasure and excitement of going back to those classrooms and sit and watch the teacher who is teaching me, you know, my teacher used to be Pramila Robertson, used to teach me English, Susan Chapman used to teach me Hindi, Mr. Narendra used to teach me physics. You know, you get that flair and the flavor of those classrooms even after 40, 50 years of you leaving the school. And
this
cannot be replaced. And, you know, morning prayers and having lunch together, fighting with the friends, you know, nagging them, pulling those hairs of the girls. You know, you sit behind and pull those. And, yeah, what are you doing? All those fun, you can't get it on a live class. And I'm sure the things are going to shape a little more into the classroom, you know, attendance in the classrooms, and then maybe a couple of days in the live class. So it's going to be a blended experience. That's what I feel.
Interestingly, Kicha, you have touched on another topic. That's communication.
Absolutely, yeah.
Communication, you know, that the modes of communication in the classroom, offline, everything. Especially my children, you know, they catch on your vibrations.
You know, one minute, Sindhu, before you start, my children, you didn't say anything about your children. What is this angels, you know, what is that organization? What is that? Could you just explain? How did you start this? How big, you know, because then we will be, my viewers will be able to understand a little more louder and clear. Over sure. to you about your institution. You're doing a wonderful job. It's sort of a service. I think I appreciate you. Say kudos to Sindhu for starting this at Dubai. And quite a few, you need to have a separate mind for this. And I'm sure that very few people have the similar mind of helping other people, you know. And after all, life is not for yourself, life is for others too. And the tendency to help, I think, you know, the needy people, whether it is physical, whether it is mental, whether it is in any way, the helping mentality, very few people have. And Sindhu, let me appreciate you for that mentality of helping people. That's what I mentioned to Swami when we started off this conversation, that Sindhu is in the art of giving. Kudos to you. We salute you for that organization.
Thanks.
Many of those children who are with you would have been benefited. It's not just you know, saying a job well done. Absolutely not. We want many Sindhus to come forward and establish such an organization for the benefit of those needy children. We are for them. And over to you, Sindhu. I become a little emotional when somebody does those excellent, you know, which others don't do. I may not have that mind. Right, but you had the mind. Kudos to you.
Kicha, heavenly angels is not a one person thing, because it's impossible for one person to do anything. It's a wonderful set of people out there. We have lovely volunteers and parent volunteers there who makes it all possible. I play just a small role there. We bring in these children. This is a support group for families of special need children. We have autistic, Down syndrome, CP, all different types of disability. And we bring them together. Basically, what we feel is that they don't get enough opportunities. And it all started with a thought of, let's put them all on the stage, because these children hardly see the stage. Putting them on the stage had two reasons. One was, of course, to give confidence to the child, him or herself. More than that, it was for the parents, so that the parents get motivated and feel more confident about their children. That was a basic aim. By God's grace, we started getting very good stages, many celebratory stages. And we used to always form these programs in such a way that we never put the disability of the child out there for sympathy or empathy or whatever you say. We just wanted people to see them for their ability and not the disability. So, when your intentions are that's the way it would show also. So that way, we slowly started growing up. But sad to say, we are not registered. We are nothing like that. We are just a group of families, and we are not increasing the numbers also because of that. It's not easy to handle. So we are around 30, 40 families with very capable children there. And every single day is a surprise. We have one child or the other, coming up with new creative things. And the mothers there are amazing. I mean, kudos to those mothers, because if you think I am doing something, it is nothing, Kicha, because I am doing it still from my comfort zone, I would say. But those mothers, they under so much of stress. In spite of that, they come about, and not just for their children, for the other children as well. So it is three cheers to them. And we have a silent parent behind the screen. That those are the fathers. They always stand behind and support, so that the mothers can go forward. And this is being more of, might be, more of girls there. You might see a lot of mothers, but no, we have a strong set of fathers behind it. Without that support, absolutely no, we would not be able to move forward. So that's my angels. And if ask me about angels themselves, there is nothing much to do for them, because the support group is basically for the family. The children are such innocent, perfect children. I mean, they love you unconditionally. And I think I communicate with most of them, might not be through speeches or whatever. I find myself very comfortable with them and very happy with they around. And they also have taught me to know my own child much better. And I have got down from being that helicopter parent and giving my own child a little more room and space to grow.
So were you a helicopter child? I mean, parent.
Of course, 100%. I was that one helicopter parent who wouldn't allow anybody near my child.
So now how do you go? You go to Australia in a helicopter and keep watching what she's doing now?
No way. That's why she's blooming.
Anyway,
she's doing very well, and she's a blessed child.
Simply thanks a lot. And I agree with you that it's not just one-man show as far as the angels are concerned. It's a group again. It's a teamwork. And certainly, as you rightly said, the three cheers to the parents who are, in fact, contributing towards the success of these angels and making them smile every day. And that's something really which each of us must try, that at least keep people smile. That is, I always believe, it's in life what is there. I say smile is contagious, and the more you smile to someone, that person makes 1,000 people smile. So keep smiling, and it's so nice to see our children, smile, especially the angels.
That's my Gurudev's one-liner, to bring a smile on everybody's face.
Absolutely. I mean, I'll take you back to those, the teaching fraternity. And this is what my feeling is all about. Whether there is going, there is there some discrimination by the teacher with all the students in a class. When I say all the students, the teacher would come and say, "Oh, I love you all," the teacher says loudly. But heart of heart within the teacher, I've seen in most of the cases, that even now, that the students who are really good at studies, I mean, just listen to me very carefully. The students who score those high marks, you know, there could be out of 40 or 50 students, about 5 or 10 would be extremely good in their academics and they score high marks. And the teachers have something with regard to partiality for those students. And students, you know, their intake or understanding of a subject is poor. You can call them the middle or the last row bunches, you know. There is absolutely the treatment is totally different. And I think that is still continuing. I'm not very sure about it. Maybe I'm wrong. I stand corrected. Because I've seen many of my classmates going through this. The teacher doesn't like me because I don't score good marks. I don't score good marks because I'm not able to understand as quickly as my friend Sheila, right? My friend Sheila, you know, she understands within 5 minutes. It takes 50 minutes for me to understand, so I'm not able to score. But the teachers have the discriminatory thoughts in their mind that I love those children who score high marks. And if there is a discrimination, it can be even not just marks, even people, I mean, you know, physically challenged children. I mean, I don't know. I mean, I don't want to open up all this.
The funda is very simple.
Yeah, tell me.
The children that you told about, you know, who has marks like temperature degree, 99.4 and 98.5 and 90, you know, in our days, like the WhatsApp message, you know, those days only temperature was like the body temperature only used to increase like that. Now the marks are on those scales, 98.
But I hope it has not crossed 100.
Let's hope that.
Yeah.
The simple funda is those children don't take that much of your energy. It is you don't have to put in that much of an effort and energy for those children. That would happen naturally. But you would need to put in a little more effort, energy, and patience for the other children. Which do we have in this fast-paced life? Do we really have that kind of patience? You know, now it has been broadened. I mean, it's been classified as what? Poor children who don't study, the 40% one, the 70% one, they are not good at studies. It's also autistic children there, dyslexia, all these together form the school. When did we start having, now the scenario is like all these children are failures. The only 90 plus has to have a place under sun. All the rest are failures. Now this percentage of failures have been slowly increasing, and now 90% are failures, only 10% is in the success rate, the 90 plus. This is total discrimination. When we were in school, how many special schools did we have? Didn't we have any slow learners in our class? Definitely. What was wrong even if you repeated a class? You just go to one class down. You repeat the class, so what? Okay, you did have, I'm not saying, of course, there was a matter of shame and whatever, but these things were not something great. We would accept all the children. I would say the acceptance even then wasn't that great, but it was much better than the acceptance that we are seeing these days. Now, even in special school, we have another category. Highly autistic, high-functioning autistic, low-functioning autistic, dyslexia, Down syndrome, who is having... Give me a break. Why are you discriminating children? Why are you discriminating them? Why can't you put them all under one tree and teachers, please, start catering for them? So, in Australia, like I told you, my niece is doing her master's in teaching. She was telling me, Mimi, I'm learning now how to deal with if a child is having dyslexia, if a child is having a learning disability. So from teaching to be a teacher itself, from there they need to be molded. Forget about it. I'm not sure, I've been told, even in medicine, One of my mothers told me that, you know, the special needs children. You know, Sindhu, those papers, you know, when you are doing your physics exam, there will be some papers of modern physics or electronics that is not that very important and you can skip. Autism was one such subject in MBBS, is what she says. There is not much of teaching happening in autism, or there's not much of, it's only now that there's a lot of research and stuff going on for these autistic children and everything. And now it has become so huge that every single place has got early intervention therapy centers. I don't know, I'm not sure whether it is all money making schemes or it's really needed or it can be integrated into main school streaming. I have no idea, but I feel we should bring them all under one roof of schooling and be able to cater them. Otherwise, what are you going to do? You're going to create in the society, what are you going to do? You're going to create such patches. I mean, we all have to be there in the society together, right? You cannot be having patches like this. Even now, I know most of my parents are thinking of a what after me. They want a colony. They want a community where only their children are there. Where are we heading to? Don't we know to live in unity and help each other? Why is this happening? This discrimination is something, I don't know, I really can't take, and I'm really against. Yes, they need extra help. I know that. Let's provide that all under one roof. Let's not discriminate them.
Sindhu, which means all of us have to now go back to the drawing room, or we need to go back to the basics in education. Since you mentioned now, in my school days, there were, of course, slow learners, fast learners. I don't know. I don't call them slow learners, fast learners. What is there to say slow learners and fast learners? Yeah, come on. I mean, they learn. You know, like, for example, you know, each human being is different. That particular child, you know, may be slow in understanding physics, but should be really strong in mathematics. So I don't even like to call them as slow and fast learners. You know, that itself, category itself is wrong. I mean, I don't even appreciate anybody calling. Everybody are learners. And
high functioning. You're missing out on words. High functioning.
High functioning. And I'm sorry, because, you know, when I start thinking, sometimes I miss out on my words. And luckily, I didn't use any other word, so using the right word, so that you must appreciate me. And what I want to ask is, like, when you have to go back to the drawing room, Sindhu, and relearn, you know, what things were happening in the older times. So each of us need to go back to the basics. Is that what you're saying? And if one has to go back to the basics in teaching, how far one has to go? How deeper one has to go?
If you ask me, all these things took me back to going ahead and analyzing education and how it was over the years, what happened, a different type of educations. I came up with something called Vedic education. Vedic education is the Gurukul system that we used to have that goes back to 5000 BC. And in Vedic age, where students were taught various subjects and about how to live a cultured and disciplined life. Now, what is the difference between this Gurukul and modern education? The difference basically is that in Gurukul education, it entirely consists of Vedas, epics, literature. And in modern education, it includes subjects like science, maths, English, etc. In general, the whole society used to be responsible for the education of students. That is how it used to go back in Gurukul times. And they used to miss out the benefits of modern academic education, and they learned Vedic sutras remain there, and the rest of their life they were dependent on charity and goodwill of people in the Vedic education. But now you have Sri Sri University, Amrita University, they don't thrive on the policy of making Vedic education viable. You know, it's not you cannot start it on charity, and charity doesn't start with an empty bowl. You're not going to be able to give anything. Now, so go back to what is happening here. Go back to all these type of education. In Gurukul system, again, you see more focused and they possess more concentration power than normal children. You know, they do a lot of recitation. They do a lot of memorization techniques. Why do you do this recitation? When you do a lot of recitations, it helps you build new cognitions. All these used to happen Gurukul system, but when we came to modern education, these started dropping out and it's now just memory, ratamar. And then you tail out of, I mean, out of your memory, you keep writing your exams and just after the exam, you have forgotten it all. You know, that's how it's coming to.
But 1 minute, Sindhu, I'm sorry for again interrupting you on this subject. It's called rote learning, you know?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I mean, you mean to say you are recommending that
children... No, I don't recommend. No, in Vedic times, you had recitation and memorizing.
Okay, fine.
These two things were forming new cognitions.
Okay,
but
fine.
But now, over time, one has dropped. And another thing, another very, very interesting thing is that when did this modern education come in? This modern education, when did it start in India? In India, it is from 1830s. By Thomas Macaulay. I'm not sure if I'm spelling his name right.
Thomas Macaulay.
Macaulay, correct. Now, however, he was here only for 4 years and his love for education was not for the love for India. That was not the reason.
For British.
Exactly. Why did he do that? For the importance and superior European values. That's what happened. So we all know that from then the education system has been getting diluted. And now we have done away with the Vedic type of education wherein Indian culture and rich heritage was a foundation. But now it is not that. It's absolutely not that. It is more of European values. What has happened. And another very interesting thing, what I came to see is that there is some other education which is even older than this modern education. You know what it is? Can you guess?
I don't know.
It's China's formal education system.
Chinese formal education system. What is that?
It's supposed to be the oldest in the world.
Now, what is that? What does it happen in the Chinese?
I haven't gone and done much research.
That is older
what
than.
What I see is Robert type of products.
Okay.
I don't know. I have to go and look into it. Another one very interesting way of education would be the Japanese education as well. That's got Zen and temples. That will also be something very interesting to look into, because you know Indians, we always don't want something that is there with us. We always keep looking out. I sometimes feel, you know, if Japan becomes the new West and we start getting our education from there, or even if the real West now starts giving us yoga, meditation, we Indians would accept it much better. You know, you see a Westerner doing yoga, meditation, you will call it mindfulness, you'll call it any names and you're ready to accept. But if you say that the same thing is being given from India and from Gurukul and from a guru, no, it's not interesting. I think those cognitions are something that we need to update.
I agree with you. And especially even, you know, like Sanskrit, you find there are so many foreign countries, many of the schools keep chanting those slogans, Sanskrit slogans. And today, Sanskrit, sometimes you forget. Even I studied Sanskrit in my school, you know. Aham
gacchami, ya gunte. We have mukam karoti vachalam. We have all those things. Sanskrit is a base. Why are Westerners now using Sanskrit? Because they understand the vibrations and they also say it helps a lot in coding. In the IT industry. Absolutely. There is a lot of scientific evidences behind this.
Yeah. But
and they are accepting like, and we are sort of dropping it.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree with you. And Sindhu, what I'm trying to now say is that the new educational policy, which is 2020, I'm sure if we're able to implement in the right manner, we would certainly take our system of education in par with the global standards, no doubt about it. And that has been done through lots and lots of feedbacks from close to about 2.5 lakhs people across the country, even from the remotest of the places in India. So it has been done very well. Mr. Kasturirangan and the team need to be congratulated for that. And I'm sure it's all student-centric. There is no pressure for the students. But today, the system in education is every child is under pressure. I mean, you are talking about, I would like you to rewind what they mentioned, that if you're under stress, you don't achieve anything in life. To see success, we need to free the mind, as you rightly said. I'm going back to whatever you mentioned. You do a 10-15 minutes of meditation, you free your mind, and then you start doing whatever you want to do. So this new education policies,
Teacher, the very thing about stress, it's right under your nose, your breath. Your breath is the answer for reducing stress. And that's what your Art of Living teaches you in the happiness program.
One or two of those, if you could tell us, and we could practice at home so that our children, in fact, reduce their stress. I always believe when you're under stress, you become mad, right? When you're under stress, either to learning or to managing a house or with your friends or with your official work, when you are under stress, you don't produce 100% results. And I would like you to now, before we wind up on this, it's a wonderful talk with you, Sidhu, no doubt about it. We can keep carrying on for hours, but then my viewers do not
be able to let me quickly close this by introducing
you can add whatever you want.
Let me just tell you about breath. How do you feel when you're stressed and when you're anxious? If you would pay attention to your breath, and when you're absolutely relaxed, and when you're listening to music, or when you're just sitting back, your quality of breath, both are totally different. You know, right now, what we're going to do is that we understand when you are stressed, you have a certain pattern of breath, and when you're relaxed, you have a certain pattern of breath. So you reverse the technique, and using your breath, you start changing your moods, your emotions. This is what is being done by Sudarshan Kriya, which you can learn in your happiness program by Art of Living. And we also teach you pranayams, breathing techniques. It would just take 15 to 20 minutes every day of your life. I mean, you could practice that. And the program itself is only a 4 days program for 2.5 hours. And it's also being given online now in the comfort of your own home. I would really suggest to go ahead and check out on happiness program and do it. This will be the one step you would do for yourself, giving yourself some priority. If you are not going to, I always tell that to my mothers, if you are not going to be there on your priority list, don't expect to be in anybody's priority list. Do a little self-love and give yourself that 2.5 hours for 4 days and learn the technique. This has really helped a lot of people. We have around 4.3 million people following, and we are in 158 countries, I guess. We have the statistics. So if these many people must be doing it and must be finding benefit,
actually,
kuch to hai.
Kuch nahi, bahut kuch hai. Kuch ki koi baat nahi hai, bahut kuch hai. And Sindhu, let me try and invite Swami now. Swami, are you there? And if you're there, certainly we would like to have your presence. Swami, are you there? Yes, there comes Swami. So Swami, we had a lengthy discussion on various aspects on education beyond borders. And now Swami is back for the concluding, not remarks, concluding clarity.
I heard that you're traveling to Japan and several other countries, education and so many things you were discussing.
Pipeline.
Yeah. So my question is, see, now this new education policy, the national education policy, is being implemented, and it is going to be an eye opener for the upcoming generation. And the key part in delivering or achieving the goals is we need to educate the teachers, or the teachers need to be aware of what is what. And in the new education policy that is being planned to be implemented in India, so what is your thought on the link between the understanding of this spirituality or accepting the new education policy and understanding the spirituality? Basically, we started off with the acceptance. Now the pandemic situation, all the teachers are at home and they have to manage their work at home as well as they have to work from home. And the transition towards the technology, moving from the conventional type of learning teaching process to technology, that is very, very tough and very tedious. And I'm sure that most of the student teachers are finding it difficult to embrace that change. So how do you think that the concept of acceptance and understanding of the spirituality will help them to embrace this change, as well as embrace the change that is about to come in the near future?
Okay. First and foremost, what I would say is that if I need to be understanding you and you need to be understanding me, we both of them must be in the same frequency. Unless we all vibrate in the same frequency, there's going to be a lot of misunderstanding. What I say, it is not just with my words that I'm going to be conveying to you. That's one thing that we didn't talk about, Kicha, the communication. You know, the communication channels needs to be flowing properly. It has to be vibrating in the same manner. If one is on the higher vibration and the other is in a lower vibration, you know what happens to energy? It just gets depleted to the lower. So the basic need would be that all of us should be vibrating in the same frequency, should be able to understand each other without misunderstandings. So if this has to happen, coming from Art of Living background, I don't see any other means other than having yoga, meditation throughout for everyone, so that we are all in the same page of receiving.
That's wonderful. Swamiji, what else you want to clarify now?
I can't hear you.
Swamiji, what else you want to clarify? Yours is on.
Yeah, as you rightly said, in fact, the concept of this yoga and meditation, or practicing this yoga and meditation, is in everyday life, will certainly change the way in which you look at your life. It will certainly change the way in which you perceive things and even others as human beings. So that is the way in which it is going to affect your life as well as the profession. So you nicely put, in fact. So you are saying that if we practice this yoga and meditation or similar sort of practices in your daily life, you think that we can easily embrace the change that is happening in the life, right?
Absolutely, absolutely.
Okay. So you think that it can be easily imparted, because the teachers have to accept this first, and then only they can impart this to the children, right?
Absolutely correct.
So so what will be the best option? You are saying that you practice meditation in the morning. So how do you think that it is practically possible for a teacher who starts the life in the maybe early hours of maybe 7 o'clock, 7:30, before that she has to cook the food and prepare the slides or the presentation or whatever? Because now the situation is changing. Whatever I used to write in the book and I used to use it for a long time, now you have to prepare the slide and you have to make sure that it is properly aligned and things formatted and things like that. So how do you think that you can find time for this meditation practice?
Let me start with myself. I have been practicing Art of Living for the past 8 years. My daughter is 19 now, so 8 years means she was 11. a teenage daughter's mother was not is not a easy thing, which most of the teenage mothers would daughters with I mean mothers with teenage daughters would agree. On top of it, I had a job. I have a full-time job, and I have my family as well. Yes, I have a very supportive husband, and that made a huge difference, and a very supportive family, always there for my passion. So that made a huge difference, but it was not easy, and it was a balance. Do you know how to ride a cycle? Life is exactly the same. It's a balance. It's a balance that you will create. Initially, you might find it a little difficult. So choosing the best time to start off initially, give it yourself. What my Guruji says is that do it for 21 days or just take it up as a challenge for 40 days. And then it will fall into, it will become a habit. So that's all is a struggle. And then it becomes, now I can't find time. I don't have the energy. That's because your energy is low. Once you start these practices, you would need only half the time what you need to do something. Your mind is so sharp. Your work gets done. Right now, I feel, you know, even my office must, I mean, it's such an easy thing. Your job becomes so easy because you're so alert. You're in the present moment, giving in your 100%. Your work is done faster. So this is what I have been doing. So that's what I can relate to or explain.
Yeah, it was correct. It is correct, really. Whatever you said is correct. Because, see, the moment you start practicing, you will find very find difficulties in coping up. But over a period of time, if you keep the same pace, then you realize that it is possible. So that will bring you more confidence, and it will increase your willpower. It will increase your determination. So those qualities will definitely help you to do the same, or the same theme or pace can be managed with your profession. So thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much for the exploration. And let me thank Krish also to he was instrumental in bringing you to this the platform. So Krish, you can wind up with the concluding remarks.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind winding it up, but then I need to certainly mention about Sophia. Sophia, thank you so much for your suggestions on the chat box. It's quite worthy to read, and then hopefully we practice that. So thank you so much, ma'am, for your comments on the chat box. So, Sindhu, whatever begins well has to end well, and I'm confident that many of us who have been viewing this program from 4 o'clock have been benefited in some way or the other, or in many ways or the other. And it has certainly also been an eye-opener for me, and I'm sure that let me try and meditate, because it's not that easy to meditate. So also,
I would only recommend every single school or a college or an institution to definitely include yoga and meditation into their curriculum. Just like KVs had, we Kendri Vidyalaya had yoga. I don't know now what's happened, but we used to have yoga and meditation. Transcendental meditation was introduced to me, and yoga was introduced to me in school.
When is the yoga day? Like 21st of
July. July.
21st of July?
Yeah.
Yeah, the students, they organized yoga day 21st of July 2020, and then they do it next yoga in 21st of July 2020. Let's be very clear. It's just not an eye wash. I mean, it's just not that for the particular day of the day for yoga day. It's not that. That has to be regularly practiced, as rightly mentioned by 21st of June, right? Okay, 21st of June is the yoga day, and let me tell you that whatever you practice for 21 days, it becomes habit. And when you do it for 30, 40 days continuously, it never leaves your go. So keep practicing whatever has been told by Sindhu on meditation, yoga, all those stuff. And I'm sure these are all available in YouTube. And 15 minutes or 30 minutes is not a long time, 30 minutes in a day. Because I always say one thing, Sindhu, and I want to repeat this. This is captioned by Medal Krush, saying that the most busiest man in this world has the maximum time to spare. I repeat, the most busiest man in this world has the maximum time to spare, because he values time. The more you value time, more time you have. You will never have time to waste. And this is my caption I keep on telling across all the schools, wherever I go for my orientation. So with this small little word, with this small little caption of mine, Sindhu, thanks a ton. Thanks a million.
Thank you so much.
Enlightening us about so many facts on education beyond borders. And Swamiji, it was our pleasure to have you back.
Thank you, Kitcha. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. On behalf of the Vishwavidyapeetham, we once again thank both Swami and Sindhu for being with us for the big talk. And till we meet again, stay safe, stay secure. And this is Medhul Krish signing off from Amal Vishwavidyapeetham.
Jai Gurudev.
Jai Hind. Yeah, Jai Hind. Thank you so much.